let's do it. Ready?
Hold on.
Are we good?
When there's a problem and there seems no hope, I don't just sit around and moan, 'cause I can drop in on my friend, and there's no problem that he can't mend, and I can drop in. Every time that I pray, in this word I feel right at home. All his promises I call my own. I can sit with him at his throne. His ability to me he has shown, and I can drop in.
Truth endureth to all of us the same. Enter in.
that which endures.
Yes. Amen. Amen.
In Jesus' name.
Thank you, Lord.
Just before we pray out, I want to thank the Lord. I want to remember Brother Terry and Sister Carol for traveling mercies upon the road here today and tomorrow, as well as those of us that are going down to New Hope in Alabama once again. But thank the Lord that he's with us now and forever. Amen. In Jesus' name. As we bow our heads and pray, we thank you, dear Lord, that you are with us. Father, be with us in every step that we take.
Yes.
Father, be with us in all our journeys, even as you were with the saints of old who endured the perils of their times. But Father, it just it led to a glorious place, because we get somewhere when we go in Jesus' name. So we thank you, Lord, for our blessings. We thank you for the spirit of healing and the spirit of truth that resides within us, Father. May that just indwell the soul now and forever through the name and faith of Jesus Christ our Lord. We thank you, Lord, for all the praises that lift us up, that lift up our spirits. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And amen. Well, thank the Lord. Thank the Lord that we're with him every day. Every day with Jesus.
Every day with Jesus is sweeter than the day before. Every day with Jesus, I love him more and more. Jesus saves and keeps me by his power, and he's the one I'm waiting for. Every day with Jesus is sweeter than the day before. Every day with Jesus is sweeter than the day before. Every day with Jesus, I love him more and more. Jesus saves and keeps me by his power, and he's the one I'm waiting for. Every day with Jesus is sweeter than the day before. Every day with Jesus is sweeter than the day before. Every day with Jesus, I love him more and more. Jesus saves and keeps me by his power, and he's the one I'm waiting for. Every day with Jesus is sweeter than the day.
Let's come and drink of it, shall we? Come and drink of the water of life.
Come and drink of the water of life freely given. It's the source of our power, miracle love. You must do something yourself, and the Spirit will quicken the word that lives in your heart.
That we have, it's a gift implanted within our souls.
Right.
It comes from the throne above, but thank the Lord we can make it to be on the increase.
Amen.
In Jesus' name. God bless each and every one. Brother Bill is going to come forward. Thank the Lord for the worship, for the praise that brings us into the presence of the Almighty God. Amen. Brother Bill.
bless Brother Ryan. God bless everyone this evening. We're here to express worship from our hearts to Jesus Christ our King.
Amen.
Amen. Well, for our first selection, we will sing Peace in the Valley.
And you're the one that mentioned it, Brother Ryan.
Peace in the valley for me.
Peace that passeth all understanding.
Yeah.
Thank the Lord for it. God bless your brothers and Sister Miriam on the piano for us. Sister Rachel's going to sing for us. Gratitude.
I just want to give thanks and gratitude to the Lord for His healing powers. I was having pretty intense back pain that was going down my legs into my feet even, and through my arms to my hands. And I just woke up this morning knowing I needed to do something, so I took some action on the medical part and came here knowing that I was gonna get what the Lord has for me already.
Amen.
And I felt just the heaviness and the weight of all of the pain and just different things just drop. And what a relief, and I'm grateful. So I'm going to sing gratitude.
Thank you.
Thank you. All my words fall short. I've got no.
Chicken!
Beautiful, Sister Rachel. God bless you for that. For our next selection, we will sing, Let's Do God's Will.
And have the revelation.
Amen. God bless you, brothers and sisters. And for our next selection, Sister Margo will sing for us, Glory, Glory to His Name.
Glory, glory to His name. The Word indwells my soul. The truth is out, His light revealed, shows me the way to go. We've heard the message for our age. The trumpet has given the call. God is telling us to hearken quickly so we can stand, not fall. We don't sit and wait or sit and mope to see what will be our lot. We just take up the Word of God and give it all we've got. Glory, glory to His name. The Word indwells my soul. The truth is out, His light revealed, shows me the way to go. We don't go by what we feel or what might come to mind. We look unto the Word of God and leave our fears behind. The love of God came down to us. He took the form of a man. He shed His blood on Calvary's tree. He was the great I Am. Glory, glory to His name. The Word indwells my soul. The truth is out, His light revealed, shows me the way to go. His blood's been shed, the Word gone out, put off man's fleshly ways, then put on the new man, walking in the Spirit each day. Put down the flesh and sensual mind and do His perfect will. Just walk by faith wherever you go, and He will see that you are filled. Glory, glory to His name. The Word indwells my soul. The truth is out, His light revealed, shows me the way to go. We've put on all His armor now. We hold His sword up high. No turning back, the battle's here. Our hand is on the plow. We walk by faith each step we take. Faith has become our shield. Because we know the truth at last, to man we will not yield. Glory, glory to His name. The Word indwells my soul. The truth is out, His light revealed, shows me the way to go. Glory, glory to His name, the Word indwells my soul. The truth is out, His light revealed, shows me the way to go.
Amen. Very good, Sister Margo. God bless you for that. For our next selection, the sisters will sing for us, Cast All Your Cares.
Cast all your cares.
Cast all your
what you're going through. Why don't you cast all your cares upon the Lord? Cast all your cares,
cast all your cares
upon the Lord.
Upon the Lord.
Cast all your cares.
Beautiful sisters, God bless you for that. Sister Marim on the piano. For our last selection, we will sing Right on Time.
Jesus, your friend's about to die, but tarry he's still on behind. So they laid Lazarus in a tomb and said their last goodbye. Then coming down the road was Jesus right on time. Just hold on, my child, because he's not too far away. And he knows your need before you pray. your feet are weary from the mountain you have climbed. Look ahead, here comes Jesus right on time. I've struggled through life's deserts, they were so hot and dry, till it seemed all hope was gone and I would die. And I've wondered, where was he? Is he still a friend of mine? That coming down the road was Jesus right on time. Just hold on, my child, because he's not too far away. And he knows your need before you pray. So when your feet are weary from the mountain you have climbed, look ahead, here comes Jesus right on time. Just hold on, my child, because he's not too far away, and he knows your need before you pray. So when your feet are weary from the mountain you have climbed, look ahead, here comes Jesus right on time. So when your feet are weary from the mountain you have climbed, look ahead, here comes Jesus right on time.
I want God's way to be my way.
I want God's way to be my way as I journey here below. For there is no other highway that a child of God should know. Though the way be dark and rough, if he leads, it is enough. I want God's way to be my way every day. Yes, I want God's way to be my way as I journey here below. For there is no other highway that a child of God should know. Though the way be dark and rough, if he leads, it is enough. I want God's way to be my way every day. Yes, I want God's way to be my way as I journey here below. For there is no other highway that a child of God should know. So the way be dark and rough, if he leads, it is enough. I want God's way to be my way every day. Yes, I want God's way to be my way every journey here below. For there is no other highway that a child of God should know. Though the way be dark and rough, if he leads, it is enough. I want God's way to be my way every day. Yes, I want God's way to be my way every day.
Amen. God bless you, brothers and sisters, and if we'll all stand before Pastor Ryan comes to bring forth the word of truth unto us, we're going to sing, "There's a River of Life."
As we seek unto the Lord and give him honor and give him praise, Sister Miriam plays through. Father, we thank you as once more we draw water from the wells of salvation. As we enter into the gates of praise, Father, we just come with glad hearts and thanksgiving therein. Father, looking for the blessings whereby you have blessed us forevermore. Father, let there be life this day. Let there be praise. Let there be the speaking of the word. Let there be the blessed amens, Father, that give you all the glory and praise, for it is due you. You alone are worthy to be praised in worship. So, Father, we lift up our worship. We lift up our praise unto you in Jesus' holy name. In all these things, we give you the glory. Amen and blessed amen. Well, thank the Lord. Thank the Lord that he is good to us. Thank the Lord that he constantly abides. You may be seated. Thank the Lord for the blessings that come from on high. We have many reasons to be grateful and to have gratitude in the name of Jesus. God's favorite attitude is gratitude. So thank the Lord that we're blessed in him. So blessed be the name of the Lord Most High God, to whom glory belongs and from whom all blessings flow. Because he lives, we live. Might have to cut the volume on the speaker. I'll let others make that decision, but you may have to there. Thank you. Because he lives, we live. And we thank the Holy Spirit for the gift of life that was put into our creation. When God put breath of life into the man Adam, and he became a living soul. And yes, there was a form of life before Adam, as the man was created from the dust of the ground, formed from the physiology of the pre-Adamic race. But Adam was the first of his kind because he had a different spirit within him. And he had a different soul. So being fashioned in the image that God chose to make him as a thoughtful, expressive, contemplative, compassionate being with eternal qualities such as love and faith, and then placed into the paradise that the Garden of Eden was, the will of a Savior came to be known. And that's the start of our story as to the spiritual and the physical origins. But of course, the thought process that came much earlier, as we were in the Lord's thoughts. We were in his plans before the worlds were framed by the word of God. So the blessings there meant to last for as ever. God is the God of the living. And he is the God of the living, in the words of our title, he is the God of the living throughout all generations. So our title is that, throughout all generations. As God spoke in the beginning, in the Genesis of mankind, in order to bring life to the fore, to bring it to pass, to be with him as a companion bride elect, but as, of course, as you know, you're very aware, it's been a battle to attain that status as a bride of Christ, but nonetheless, there's always this, the battle is the Lord's. It's his responsibility to get us there. And the victory is assured, and the word of God still reads, the Spirit and the bride say, come. So that tells me there will be a bride elect to be there to say, come unto the Lord. Be where we are as we're gathered together, which is delivered to us in Consummation Book, final chapter, Revelation 22 and verse 17. So before the Genesis beginning, before the angelic creation, wisdom was God's companion. But that same wisdom knew that life had to be expressed in children, for that was the elemental desire of the Almighty, in order to be a father, and then having fulfilled that, to then show greater love. And God has done these things, fulfilling it all in Christ, and it always was Christ from the beginning. For the thought of Christ was within the Almighty. Christ is the expression of the Almighty God. And that was true before the Bethlehem birth. 1 Corinthians 10, chapter 10, in the fourth verse, proclaims it's always been Jesus who was the rock that led the Exodus people out of the land of oppression. Paul wrote in Colossians 1, verses 15 and 16, that Jesus was the image of the invisible God, and that by him were all things created. Now that pretty much settles it for me. Jesus is the expression of the Almighty God, the Word made flesh to dwell among us. And that particular verse of Colossians chapter 1 leads to verse 19, which says, the fullness of God was held within Christ. So the person of Christ, God was manifest in the flesh, the crossroads of every purpose under heaven. It all came down to that moment in time there at Golgotha. So all things before depended upon the promise of it. It all had to come to that place. All things after depend upon the fulfillment that happened from everything from Bethlehem to Mount Calvary, from Gethsemane to Ascension off the Mount of Olives. It all depended upon the birth, the life, the death, and the resurrection of Christ. And those are the basics. It's always good to go over the basics and all that we talk about. Those are the essential events that speak to us throughout all generations. And that gives us purpose and meaning. It gives us a life. I mean, it gave you your actual life. And if you find purpose in the Almighty, that gives you your purpose for life. There's more than just punching the clock at the end of a work day or looking forward to the weekend. This is what gives you a real purpose. It gives you real importance. It matters. Each and every soul matters in Jesus' name. It gives you all that. And it makes all the sacrifices worthwhile, especially so for that perfect sacrifice which was upon the cross. Made that worthwhile. And the principles of the love of one God and one another work through these events written, and they're testified to complete the labor and complete the work of all that the prophets and apostles, all that they worked towards, to finish the course faithfully and to prove their discipleship and their sainthood. And there's a lot to the story. I learn new things continuously. Whenever I get to thinking I'm so smart, I'll learn something to buy. Boy, I didn't know that. Amen. God's got a lot more in store there. So revelation is a continual source of renewal, and it's a lifetime pursuit. We don't just stop where we were at the age of 20 or 30 or 40 or on through the count of years. It lasts a lifetime. It's carried on from generation to generation as we've picked up the banner of the cross from those who have labored before us. And we've all entered into their labors. And we do our work this day so that others that come after us can enter into the work that we have done and enter into our labors, and on it goes. But the source of all things is Christ. So it's quite a task that we've taken on. We're doing the same work that Paul and Peter and James and John and the Old Testament saints, Ezekiel, Daniel, Jeremiah of the prophets. We're taking on the same responsibility. We're not all prophets, we're not all apostles, but we're all part of the same household of faith, and we've become part of the story that began before the Genesis 1-1 beginning. So your story didn't start on the day that it shows on your birth certificate. Your story started before there ever was. Your story started in the timeless realm that was before Genesis 1-1, in the mind of Almighty God, for we were there in his thoughts. And the thought of us was so valued to the Almighty that he brought it all forth and gave us life. Therefore, we practice our faith. You know, the world practices another type of faith, and this is kind of a hard thought to get across. I pray I do a fair job. But you know, it takes a type of faith to be an unbeliever, because you have to believe in yourself and in selfishness so completely, it's kind of an anti-faith. It's the other side of the coin of what real faith is. The world practices anti-faith, a belief system that believes in nothing except that which can be seen and heard and tasted and touched by the natural senses, not considering that faith created all those other perceptions that live within in the first place. And eternity is at the heart of all the ways that we become who we are. And faith of itself, it doesn't exist in the material sense. It's a thought. It's a thought that ever was. It's an eternal thought. But it's what all things that do exist are made out of. Everything that can be handled was made by that which is invisible. And we're surrounded by invisible forces of gravity. Yeah. We're surrounded by what science, it can't explain, so it makes up a term. It's called dark matter. Dark matter, as science refers to the invisible substance that seems to power gravitational forces. Well, I don't know the physics of all of that. I don't have an answer for that. But I've got a spiritual answer for it. God makes the universe work. He holds it all together. He holds it all together by faith from the Creator who did all the math and put it all together through the thoughts that framed the world. For a scripture reference, let's turn to the book of Colossians, Paul's epistle to the church at Colossae. As creation is a witness, I refer to it often. It means a lot. It's something to behold. Creation's a witness to us all, no matter what a person's station in life is. We're all responsible to see God's witness. It doesn't matter what occupation or status we have in this world. The Lord's no respecter of persons. He is the literal essence of truth that ever was. And those that come before the throne, you know, I won the gold medal in the Olympics. You know, I built this business from scratch. And so none of that's going to mean anything with the Almighty God. God's the eternal one. Faith, without faith, it's impossible to please God. So all the trophies and statues and all that other stuff, that it's less than nothing to him. So thank the Lord. Now, we can do a few things in this life and achieve a few things. There's nothing wrong with that. But that doesn't give us our salvation. The salvation comes through the simple act of contrition, of belief in the heart and confession by mouth, and thus salvation comes to the house of Israel, the Israel of faith, as well as the natural seed of Israel. So having made reference to the Lord there, and I referred to it just a few moments ago in Colossians 1:19, where the fullness of God dwells in Christ, we pick it up from there at verse 20. and having made peace through the blood of his cross, by him to reconcile all things unto himself, by him I say, whether they be things in earth or things in heaven, and you that were sometimes alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now hath he reconciled. And that's wonderful. That's wonderful. That's amazing. All these people that we read about that were outside of the commonwealth of faith of Israel, the Gentile, early church, the first generation of believers, the day before they were Christians, they were just a bunch of pagans. The moment, the minute. But then when they heard the word and it got into their heart and spirit and they confessed it with mouth, then they were the saints of the living God, just like that. In a moment's time, they turned their whole life around. And those are the labors we've entered into. That momentum is still going on. So you were enemies in your mind by wicked works. Oh boy, was that ever true. But now he is reconciled. He's brought peace to your spirit. How do you do that? Verse 22. In the body of his flesh through death to present you holy and unblameable and unreprovable in his sight. A minute before, there were a bunch of pagans steeped in all the mythology, a bunch of idol worshipers, and now in the next breath, they're holy and unblameable and unreprovable in his sight. Now that's a perfect work. That's a perfect word from on high. And God's promises, they're always contingent upon faith. That's why verse 23 reads thusly, If ye continue in the faith, grounded and settled, and be not moved away from the hope of the gospel, which ye have heard, and which was preached to every creature which is under heaven, whereof I, Paul, am made a minister. If you continue in the faith, as it is that the blessings from on high, the covenants that God makes, the promises, they're always contingent and depending upon faithfulness of obedience. They always depend on the truthfulness of the Spirit, because you know the parable of the seeds and the good ground, and some ground it looks good for a while, some doesn't have any root in it and just won't take hold, some looks good for a while, but cares of this world come up and causes the life to be departed from that which is grown. But the good ground of faith, if it stays obedient, it can't fail to have the blessings. But any gift from God can be thrown away, even those that come from above. Those gifts that come from above, you can throw it away if you choose to do so. Some did. Consider Judas Iscariot, who was one of the 12. He had salvation. He had full assurance of it, but he threw it away. He saw the miracles. He saw the salvation of the Lord. He rejoiced in the light of the presence of God. Can you imagine turning away from that? It's sobering, and we should consider it all and take all things into effect. Search our own spirits and speak to our very own soul and say, soul, what are you doing in there, you know? Pay attention to what you're doing. Don't get discouraged. Just continue on in the faith that was once delivered to the saints. But Judas ignored the warnings to turn aside from his course, which Jesus gave him many, including that which comes from St. John 6:70. Haven't I chosen you 12, but one of you is a devil. Oh, my. Now, if you're in the company of the apostles and you hear a word like that, well, that would make me start to look around and consider myself. I'm going to make sure that it's not me. But that was the warning. And Judas could have switched gears. God was appealing to his conscience. He gave him every opportunity, every opportunity. He could have changed his mind, made a different choice. Regrettably, he did not. And in St. John 17:12, the master refers to Judas saying, none are lost save the son of perdition, which Judas was. Verified in St. John 18, verses 8 and 9. That does not bode well for the soul of one Judas Iscariot. So even the gifts from above, the God is a God of freedom. He lets you make free will choice. Full assurance is there, but it can be thrown away. And that serves as a warning to everyone down through the ages to base your hope on things that are eternal. Don't base your hope on 30 pieces of silver, because that isn't going to do much for you. Not in this world, not in the ancient world that Judas lived in. That was just slave wages, get you by for a few months, a meager existence. This word is set up as a beacon of hope, but it also serves notice by many warnings. This is no game. This is big time stuff. This gospel, it's serious business. As a matter of fact, it's life or death. So we have to walk with the Lord every step of the way and consider ourselves, consider our ways and doings. And with God being the living voice of the eternal truth, guided by the wisdom that was his companion, it's put that way in Proverbs chapter 8. And it was so before the beginning of time and space and matter that all came into existence simultaneously there. Time, space, and matter, it all came together in Genesis 1:1. Wouldn't that same living truth and wouldn't that same wisdom go into his written testimony that we find in our Bibles? Wouldn't the same wisdom that brought the worlds forth, wouldn't that guide the scriptures? It would. It did. It is right now. This is a living word. And people who try to find fault with the scriptures, you don't have to go far to find it. It's all over internet world, and it's all in the world at large and so forth. There's always been an element of anti-faith that runs throughout the world.
Right.
Believes in temporary things, believes in its own self-will. Lots of anti-faith out there. And people who try to find fault with the scriptures have fallen prey to the same type of thinking that once ruled during the Middle Ages, when the Roman Catholic Church got caught up in that type of thinking, made them blind when they thought Earth was the physical center of the universe, planets rotated in circular order because that was their idea of what perfection was, instead of the elliptical orbits that the planets move through space with. It just didn't fit their definition of perfect. So you have to come up with a better definition of perfect than that, because that was just a bad idea. The Bible is a perfect work because it includes the factor of humans being human. God allows people to make their choices, but works through them nonetheless. And humans being human, that means they're prone to mistakes and errors in judgment. But you know what? The word still gets out anyway. It still gets out. It still puts your name in the book of life. It gets you in heaven. And it saves your soul, and that's exactly what it was set out to do, and that makes the Bible a perfect work. Yeah. It does what it's supposed to do. It teaches you and delivers the perfect sacrifice, and if it teaches you the atoning blood, and if it teaches you the name of Jesus, get your name written above, that is perfect. That's perfect. It's a perfect work, and that's its design, and it's a chosen method. Because through the wisdom of this world, which there was much emphasis on that, we shouldn't be prejudiced against the ancient people. They weren't so different than us. Our gadgets are fancier now, but they knew how to do a lot of things and were just as intelligent as we are. But by the wisdom of this world, God was not known. So he chose the foolish, the so-called foolish things of this world, to confound the wise. He chose the weak things. Things that are despised, in order to confound those that are mighty. So those that think they're so high and mighty and they analyze the scripture and all the manners that they do, God has confounded their wisdom through the simplicity that's in Christ. And to us, it's the power of God throughout all the ages and throughout all generations. In Psalms chapter 22, you might recognize this as the Psalm of the Cross. We're going to the latter portion of Psalms 22. But Psalms 22 delivers the whole scene of Golgotha. It's the Psalm of the Cross. It's what David quoted from. or rather what it's how David opens his quotation that Jesus quoted upon the cross, and my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Same psalm. We're going to the end of the psalm at verse 27, read on from there. But the word is what stands. When all else is sinking sand, the word of God stands. And God's not willing that any should perish, but that all would come to him for life, and that more abundantly. He was looking for Judas to come to life when he said, haven't I chosen you 12 and one of you is a devil? That was a plea in order to think on your ways and doings and turn aside from the course that you are on. But having foreknowledge of that, God spoke in the prophetic spirit of foreknowledge, but that didn't change Judas's decision-making rights. He could have turned aside. He had that right. Knowledge of an event does not cause the event to happen. And Judas made the wrong choice, but it was his to make. All right. But thank the Lord for that which is written, and thank the Lord that the witness goes out through the seed of Abraham in the Old Testament, and then through the spoken word by the apostles, through which all the nations and kindreds and tongues are blessed thereby in the New Testament. And we're the Israel of faith, and we're justified by that faith, the faith that works by love. So this, where does that cross lead to? We pick it up at verse 27. All the ends of the world shall remember and turn unto the Lord, and all the kindreds of the nations shall worship before thee. Oh my, that's where the cross leads to. It'll be done. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that he is indeed Lord. Some willing, some not so willing, but all the ends of the world shall remember and turn to the Lord. All those that are of the faithful seed will do so, including this is the healing of Lebanon. It's the healing leaves off the tree of life that are there for the healing of nations in Revelation 22. It refers to all those things. And verse 28, for the kingdom is the Lord's, and he is the governor among the nations. All they that be fat, or we all know that word has negative connotations in modern English. In the King James language, those that were well fed and those that were taken care of. It's not meant to be derogatory. All they that be fat upon the earth shall eat and worship, partake of him, see. All they that go down to the dust shall bow before him, and none can keep alive his own soul. A seed shall serve him. It shall be accounted to the Lord for a generation, or for a people. Generation in the sense of people. They'll be the people of the Lord. They shall come and shall declare his righteousness unto a people that shall be born that he hath done this. Well, bless the Lord. That's the promise of the Almighty. That's where the cross leads to. That's where it leads. That's the big picture of faith, as you get the panoramic view of all that's set before us. And as a proclaimer of the gospel and from behind a pulpit, the only subject I've ever preached in my life is just put the scriptures together, let them speak, let the breath of life that's in them, let it be known. Look at those scriptures, examine them, let it work within, draw them together, say a few amens, put a few descriptive sentences around them, as much as you're able to do, because the word was designed for us to express ourselves, so we do that. But the word of God, it speaks for itself, and that's the only thing I've preached under I don't know how many hundreds of titles, but that's the only subject I've ever done. Just let the word speak. Let it indwell the soul. Then say amen to it and give a hallelujah here and there say good things and say truthful things and say eternal things, and it's going to come out all right. So this prayer song that contains the whole scene of the crucifixion that Jesus quoted, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Or, as I have speculated at times, is it more a case of David quoting Jesus upon the cross by 1,000 years of prophetic foresight in that moment of time that he saw it from afar. Who's quoting who? Now that is an interesting question. But thank the Lord, amen. My God, that had its effect. It had its effect at Calvary. And where does it take us? It takes us to a remnant seed that will serve the Lord. And that will run throughout all generations. All generations, all the ends of the world. It all comes down to that. A seed shall serve him. It'll be accounted to the Lord for a people, for a generation. It will do the job. Thy will be done, and all the ends of the world shall remember and turn to the Lord. And all the four corners of the globe, east, west, north, and south, it will run throughout. And that's central to the whole plan. The cross gets us there. That's the whole psalm leading right up to that point. It gets us to the place of a skull by translation. Golgotha, Calvary is a Latin translation of that. It gets us to that place, and then it tells us where things go after that and what the cross achieves, as all the world will turn to the Lord. As the Almighty built his word so that people would come to it out of the seed of faith, it was implanted within the soul, and that has to be nurtured. It doesn't do any good. Have you heard? I've heard this one more than one or two times. I'm not worried about salvation, you know, words to that effect. I'm just as good as anybody else. Well, the problem with that is nobody's any good. As it comes to the matter of holiness, we can describe a person as a good person. We know what we're talking about because their good qualities, they're there and so forth. But no one is holy in and of themselves. That's God alone. God alone is holy. Why callest thou me good? Remember when the person came up to Jesus and called him good master? Why callest thou me good? There's only one good but God. But now Jesus didn't refute the goodness. He just put it in such a way as to make that man think and to make us think through the generations of time, because that's who the word was intended for. So being just as good as anybody else doesn't stand you much stead in the realm of holiness. Only Jesus is good in that manner. So this verse and these verses specifically state that a people will come, that they'll be born, that they'll be witnesses of all that God hath wrought. And here we are. We're evidence, we're living evidence of what God has done, put right into the middle of the plan that was conceived by the architect of the ages. Let's turn to St. John 17. St. John chapter 17, as we'll find here in the expressions of longing, the desire to glorify God in the finished work. You've got to speak to your spirit. There's prophetic soul within these scriptures. This is taken as Jesus prays out just before his disciples cross over the book of Kedron and into the place known as Gethsemane, which is a place of the manufacture and the refining of olive oil. So Gethsemane just means there was an olive oil press. That's literally what it means. So in the place where the olives were pressed to refine the fuel that was in the lampstands in the temple. That was one of the places where they did that. All right, St. John chapter 17, verse 5. And now, O Father, glorify thou me with thine own self, with the glory which I had with thee before the world was. Now, just a few points to make from this. You know, this is one of the main things that Trinitarian doctrine will seize upon. As in opposition to oneness doctrine. You know, they'll say, does God talk to himself? Is he talking to himself? I'm going to give you a real long and complicated answer on that one. Yes. Yes, he does. Does God talk to himself? Yes, he does. Yes, he absolutely does. He talked to himself in the beginning. He talked to his companion, Wisdom. He said, let us make man in our image. And thus he did. And we speak to ourselves. I do it all the time. I did it today. Ryan, you better get up out of bed. You got to get ready and go get a service to do, so you better get yourself in gear. And at times of self-introspection, we're supposed to search our own spirits and get right down deep within and say, soul, what are you doing in there? Let's get on the straight and narrow. So does God speak to himself in that manner? Yes, he most certainly does. Absolutely does. So glorify thou me with thine own self, with the glory which I had with thee before the world was. That's eternal. That's an eternal statement. I have manifested thy name unto the men which thou gavest me out of the world. Thine they were, and thou gavest them me, and they have kept thy word, save for the aforementioned you know who. All right, verse 7. Now they have known that all things whatsoever thou hast given me are of thee. So God does speak to himself. Yes, he does. And verse 5 contains the eternity within, for the glory of Christ was before the world was. The existence of Christ did not start at Bethlehem. That was the genesis of it as to the physical being and the moment in time where the word was made flesh to manifest itself among us. But the existence of Christ did not start at Bethlehem. That was the manifesting of his name. That was there in verse 6. I have manifested thy name. Jesus is the manifestation of the name of the Almighty God. And now we have a name to cling on to. What a privilege that is. What a privilege we have in Jesus. All our sins, all our griefs to bear. When we use that blessed name and take it to the Lord in prayer. In the Old Testament era, they feared to transgress the third commandment, thou shalt not take the Lord thy God. You won't take his name in vain, which had mostly to do in the swearing of oaths. God's name was not to be used lightly or in an unholy way or in any manner, which that includes profanity, but its primary purpose was in the swearing of oaths. Don't be using God's name to swear upon whatever it is you do. His holy name is not to be used for such purposes. But now we speak the name of Jesus early. We speak it often. It's our privilege to access the very throne room of heaven. So Jesus prayed so as to partake of life as we do. Same expression. These were meant to be written, and they're examples to us. So Jesus prayed accordingly. But this was the word itself, made in his own likeness. For I have manifested your name. I am the name. I am the name. The St. John chapter 8, verse 58 saying, before Abraham was, I am. Amen. That declares it plainly. It was living out a promise and learning and experiencing as one of us and being example to us in the middle of an endless life. More than just speaking of the divine name, but living it, being it, manifesting it. As the Almighty limited himself and stayed obedient to what was ahead for our sake, to that which was ordained of him from ever, from the Genesis 3:15 promise to bruise the serpent's head. And that's exactly what the cross did. While we're in St. John in chapter 6, St. John, as the life of Jesus, was a living manifestation of God himself. It was the Messiah himself who said, no man can serve two masters. That's in my Bible, and it's not coming out. You can't serve two masters. Would the person who said that then set up a system whereby he received worship and somebody else received worship at the same time? I don't spiritually think so. You can't serve two masters, no. That would be a contradiction in terms. The Word is one. The Word is one. And that's the message for all succeeding generations. And this reference will make an I am. It'll make a source statement to that effect. St. John chapter 6, and from verse 35, And Jesus said unto them, I am the bread of life. Oh, there you go. Tree of life in the Garden of Eden. Source, I am the way, the truth, and the life. There you have it. I am the bread of life. That's an I am statement. That's an eternal identification. That I am stuff, boy, when you hear that, pay attention. I am the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall never hunger. He that believeth on me shall never thirst. But I said unto you that ye also have seen me and believe not. All that the Father giveth me shall come to me, and him that cometh to me I will in no wise cast out. Because, and it continues, I came from heaven not to do my will, but the will of him that sent me. For that purpose Christ spoke in those terms. So I am the bread of life. That's very direct. It's said to indicate an origin, a place and time, a source, a starting place. But it's given in a timeless manner. And that's no turning of an accidental phrase. It's actual. It's to the point. It identifies with this voice that spoke to Moses out of the bush that was not consumed by fire. And there's the authority of an endless life in there. There's a I am in everything that Jesus said. But this is kind of why I included this saying as to the message given throughout the generations of time. Your choices matter, because whoever comes to me, if you choose to do that, I won't cast out. Judas cast himself out. So God's not going to turn someone away because they're not on some list or something. That's why choices matter. Joshua said, as for me and my house, I'm making a choice. We will serve the Lord, and that matters. It comes down through us, through the years of time that have elapsed since then, comes to us to give us spiritual strength. There's authority there. So I won't cast anyone out that makes that choice. And the choice that we commit ourselves to the Lord when we say, as Joshua did, as for me and my house, we'll serve the Lord. We pray the prayer of salvation. Your predestination's right there. You've made the choice to be predestinated. God doesn't turn any such one away. God doesn't choose any way that choose him. He won't do that. So that speaks volumes to us right across the spiritual board. In Romans chapter 1, Romans 1. Now down through the quarters of time, by those ages and generations that we speak of, there are many dangers within, there are many traps. There's a lot of hath God said out in the world today that didn't stop from the Genesis account. There's plenty of subtlety going on right now. But in the process of time, many doubts can arise. Patience will get tested. Senses will get questioned. And that's been so ever since the voice of the serpent, natured creature, put forth that rhetorical doubting question, hath God said. So many subtleties are out there and put in place to pull one away from the tree of life that God is. And so it's been so from Eden, and it's a fight. But faith is worth striving for. And on the personal level, there will be battles. Of course, you've all noticed that. It's obvious. And there will be the battles on the international and the world stage. But if the enemy, and there is an enemy, can make even the least of prophetic events to fail, the whole work would collapse, because God has to be good in the sense of holiness. It all has to be holy, holy, holy. It has to be true. God has to maintain that standard, because if even the least of promises is upended, then holiness is breached. And in comparison language, James chapter 2 and verse 10 tells us that if any offend even one point of the commandments, if you offend in one point of the law, you've broken the whole thing. If you've broken the Sabbath law, you've transgressed the thou shalt not covet statute. And likewise, if you don't obey one, you've broken them all. No, don't rely upon I'm as good as anybody else. That doesn't get you to heaven. All, yeah. God's holiness gets you to heaven. Amen. Confession in his name. It gets you there. So if you're guilty of all, well, apply that standard to the Holy One himself. Yeah. If any one of his promises is breached, the whole work collapses because he's not found to be holy. So God has to make good on every promise that he has, including the healing of Lebanon. He's got to make that good. He's got to make all those promises come to pass. There can't be any, the least of prophecies fulfilled, as well as the major ones, major and minor. It all has to fit. It all has to be made good on every facet of promises, or else he is not holy. Now, that's quite a challenge. But the Lord of Lords and King of Kings, he's up to it. Or he's counted the cost. It would cost his blood. It would cost an act of atonement upon the cross. Or he intends to live up to it, or we wouldn't have any prophetic content in our Bibles. If he was afraid of living up to his word, we wouldn't have a book of Revelation. We wouldn't have a Matthew 24 where Jesus spoke about the signs of the times. But he intends to live up to his holiness. And so, therefore, we have great and precious promises that tells us of those things not only that were and that are right now, but those things which are to be. The promises are the covenants that must be lived up to throughout all generations, including seven of them that are so very secret that God has withheld them. John the Apostle Revelator, he saw something there on the Isle of Patmos. What that was, he was not allowed to write down. But that has to be made good. Just the fact that there are seven voices of God ready to speak at the end time to deliver the world from the bondage of sin and death. Just to know that is much. And the devil has his plans too. But God will countermand those things. And those things are withheld, the secrets of them, they're withheld until the time. The time when darkness is at the full, when the wickedness of the modern day Amorites has come to its full portion. But it's there in the thunders of Revelation 10. But so vital is that standard of holiness to the Almighty that the secret of those things are withheld until the time. But it's sobering. But it gets us to concentrate more fully. It gets us to search the scriptures and to see what we can know about these things. And in Romans chapter 1 and from verse 7, Paul in his servitude, his humbled servitude, called to be an apostle, called to be a display of God's mercy that lived through him, because he had aforetime had been the chief persecutor of the church, and now he's become its leading proclaimer. Word of God changes things. That's miraculous of itself. Only God can see the purpose of things and make the vision come forth and do its work out of a situation like that. So here in Romans chapter 1, at verse 7, to all that be in Rome, and there was a church at Rome, and God's church, you know, the original church of God, the original church of God is the one that keeps the faith of Jesus. It doesn't depend on a geographical point on the European continent. You're the original church if you hold to the faith that was once delivered to the saints. What location, the physical location a church in, has no bearing as to whether they have the original seed of faith and do the will of the Almighty, his perfect will, and that the word of God stands upon. The church is original if it holds to the faith that Jesus spoke of. So thank God for faith. There was a church in Rome. To all that was original to the faith at that time, succeeding generations would become polluted. All right, to all that be in Rome, beloved of God, called to be saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. First, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for you all, that your faith is spoken of throughout the whole world. Your faith is spoken of throughout all generations. It leads to the title of this sermon. Throughout not only the world that was then existent, but extends throughout the generations of people and of times right here and now. It comes right to you. It's meant to you personally. Time has no bearing on it. Word of God's responsible to all generations, past, present, and future. And many of those who first read this letter directly addressed to them might have been the day after, week after they were taken out and killed for the name of Jesus, and it was used for sport to entertain the masses and so forth. That early church, but it went through so much. We've now entered into their labors. Their sacrifice wasn't in vain. The sacrifice of Jesus on the cross wasn't in vain. All these things come together to bring God's will into our life. And God speaks to us. He speaks to us all throughout all generations, throughout the whatever length of time that we have until the time when all things are consummated and all things spoken of are come into place. The blood applied, it speaks, and it speaks better things than that of Abel. It speaks life to us. It speaks to every man, woman, person, child. It speaks life to us forevermore in Jesus' name. Let's stand and pray. Thank the Lord that the word's open to us and the judgments of God are made manifest. Yeah. We thank the Lord that we say the things that bring us into the fellowship of Jesus. So we fill our cup and fill it up. We thank the Lord. As we get the windows of heaven open, we're going to sing that following prayer of dismissal. The windows of heaven, they are open. The windows of heaven open up every time you turn the covers of your Bible open and read through the word of life that's manifest to us. That gets the windows of heaven open. It gets God's will made known in your life. It puts all the purpose of the Almighty God before us, lifts us up, gives us a sense of purpose. The word of God gave you your actual life, the spirit and soul that dwells within. But it also gave you your life in the sense of purpose. You're more than just a thing that goes to work. You're more than a number on a list. You're more than just a name in the phone book. You're much more than those things. A lot of those things pass away. Phone books are kind of passing away. That doesn't get used much. But you're more than just a cog in some worldly wheel. You're more than those things. You're part of the saints of Almighty God. Lord. You're part of the eternal witness that was there before the worlds were framed by the word of God. Amen. So as we bow our heads and pray, Sister Patty, Sister Mary may play through as they will. Father, we thank you for you have brought to us the words of life. Father, being fully invested in your will and seeking those things which are to come, we travel through this world as pilgrims. We don't have any continuing city here, no permanent place of residence, but we sure do seek one which is to come, which is given in the promise of the new heavens and the new earth, the Mount Zion of the new Jerusalem. Father, we depend upon those promises, knowing that the performance of them makes your name holy, so very holy, thrice holy, as witnessed before the very throne of God by the four living creatures that stand in your presence, who rest day and night, saying, "Holy, holy, holy is he." Father, giving you the glory in all things, we just come to you now in obedience to your word, Father God, as we come humbly before the throne of grace. We thank you, Lord. We know that you've heard those things which we have desired. You've heard our petitions. We thank you, Father, for traveling mercies upon the highways of this land. We thank you, dear Lord, for the recovery, even if it's of sight to the blind, Father. We thank you, Lord, for the restoring of the hearing to those that are deaf. That all generations, throughout all generations, Father, that each and every person will be blessed in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you for the word of God that lifts us up and that speaks peace to our spirits. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And amen. Well, thank the Lord. Thank the Lord for the word being open to us.
Amen.
The windows of heaven, they are open.
The windows of heaven are open. The blessings are falling tonight. There's joy, joy, joy in my heart since Jesus made everything right. I gave him my own tattered garments. He gave me a robe of pure white.
How can you refuse him?